I'm Amy Tobin, and it's a pleasure to be responding and chairing the fourth session today, which is focused on friendships and groups. So we've got two speakers, Lesley and Jovan Nicholson, who I'll introduce both before they speak. So Lesley is a curator of InkArt at M+, Hong Kong's Museum for Visual Culture. She curated The Weight of Lightness, InkArt at M+, in 2017, which explored a cross-disciplinary and trans-cultural perspective on the subject. She received an AB in History and Science from Harvard College, an MA in Museum Studies from New York University, and a PhD from University of California, San Diego, with a dissertation on abstract painting in post-war Taiwan. Our second speaker will be Jovan Nicholson, who's an independent art historian and curator who studied at London University in Russia, worked for Christie's, and between 1990 and 2000, organized exhibitions for the British Council in Russia and the former Soviet republics. More recently, he's curated and written the catalogues for Art and Life, Ben Nicholson, Winifred Nicholson, Christopher Wood, Alfred Wallace, William State Murray, 1920-1931, which toured to many wonderful institutions, including Kettle's Yard, where I work, and many other exhibitions on Winifred Nicholson, and he's got a forthcoming exhibition and monograph on Kate Nicholson, which will be published in May, and the exhibition will be at Falmouth Art Gallery. He's the grandson of Ben and Winifred Nicholson. So I'd like to ask Lesley to join me up here. And Lesley's paper is titled Taipei, Bologna, Yuan-chia's Beginnings.
Good afternoon. Taipei, Bologna, Yuan-chia's Beginnings. Yuan-chia is an artist who had many beginnings in his life. Each beginning was marked by his arrival in a new place, physically, geographically, culturally, and artistically. Each beginning was also marked whenever and wherever he drew a point, which took a variety of visual forms, round graphic dots, calligraphic brush circles, fabric patches, or magnetic photographic discs. A poem by Lee, much cited throughout the exhibition and conference, quote, "The point is the beginning of everything, and also the end," unquote, signifies the multiple beginnings and their relations with one another. In this paper, I will discuss his beginnings in Taipei and in Bologna, two places that lay the groundwork for his career. The paper will center on the artistic and cultural groups with which Lee was associated in Taipei and Bologna, as well as the social network and artistic milieu in which his work was produced and considered. At the same time, it will examine works Lee produced in the two locations to understand the formation and evolution of his ideas. These beginnings of Lee will shed light on his later multifaceted friendship-based activities in Cumbria, about which we have learned so much today. The beginnings discussed in this paper span from 1952 to 1966. Between the year Lee began a former art education at a Taipei Normal College and his departure for the UK from Bologna. In 1952, China was deep in recovery mode after the epic struggle against the Japanese invasion between 1937 and 1945, followed by the brutal civil war that resulted in a communist takeover of the mainland and a nationalist retreat to Taiwan in 1949. Lee fled with over a million other refugees to Taiwan, where cultural reorientation after 50 years of Japanese colonization had begun to unfold. Against the backdrop of Cold War geopolitics and the threat of military conflict with the PRC, the nationalist government in Taiwan implemented a staunch conservatism. Martial law dictated all aspects of quotidian life. The arts establishment maintained a support for oil painting styles developed by the Japanese, which is the ones on the left. At the same time, the government's preservationist cultural policy championed classical Chinese ink paintings, in particular landscape paintings, a genre favored and developed by scholar artists since the 10th century that embodied the tenets of Chinese philosophy and aesthetics and projected a lofty attitude toward harmonious attitude toward nature. It is in this climate that the first wave of avant-garde in Chinese art was born. You see the examples of the landscape paintings in the post-war Taiwan period on the right. On November 5th, 1957, He Fan, the influential columnist and editor of United Daily News, one of the most circulated newspapers in Taiwan, penned an article titled The Bandits' Painting Exhibition, Xiang Ma Hua Zhan. Published over two consecutive days in advance of the inaugural exhibition of Dongfang Society in Taipei, the article introduces the arrival of modern paintings, spearheaded by eight unknown artists in their 20s. What seemed like a sensational headline, in fact, was an announcement of the changing of the guard in Chinese art. By calling the young artists bandits, Xiang Ma, a term for robbers on horseback in the bygone days, who would shoot howling arrows before approaching their target, He Fan emphasized the audacity of these outlaws who had no money or social status, only a grand vision. A seasoned journalist and tastemaker in the literary and cultural circle, He Fan was a proponent of modernity and reform to bring Chinese society and culture on par with his international counterparts. While aware of the new style by young artists may upset the cultural establishment, He Fan used his social clout to argue for the rightful existence of modern painting and to promote the group, which included his nephew, Xia Yang. His article was in fact the forceful howling arrow warning the cultural aristocracy of the bandits' arrival. Established just 1 year before, in 1956, the Dongfang Society consisted of eight young painters, all but one of mainland origin, who graduated from the Taipei Normal College and took lessons from artist Li Zhongsheng. The artistic nutrients of this Cantonese-born, Japanese-educated Li Zhongsheng came from classical Chinese ink paintings, early 20th century European avant-garde paintings, underground anti-academic art in late 1920s Tokyo, and the cosmopolitan modernism of 1930s Shanghai. Li's instruction for his students was guided by a liberal spirit that favored an expressionist style. One can see easily from these examples on the slide why the students sought his instructions outside of the academy. Though the image and behavior of a bandit seems extremely unfit for the personality and the type of art Li Yuanjia is known for, one can see how his work signified a new visuality in Chinese art. A painting by him, titled As an Art, on the left, was exhibited at the 4th Sao Paulo Biennial in 1957. A loose grid with irregular lines and patches of color in the spaces between. The work was has strong traces of influences from Mondrian and Kandinsky, yet it also has qualities of ink wash and arrangement of blank space, typical in traditional Chinese painting. Li described his artistic pursuit at the time entails, quote, searching in oracle scripts and inscriptions on bronzes for the distinguished characteristics of our country's abstract art, in order to find the key element that defines our modernity, the distinguished trait of our national character, and the spirit of the modern, unquote. While the statement submitted to the Republic of China Commissioner for the Sao Paulo Biennial sounded uncharacteristically official in tone and seemed to overlook the painting's overt European modernist flavor, it summarizes Li's pursuit in this period. The abstract art was a stylistic goal. The ancient Chinese script was a key formal and symbolic inspiration, and that a Chinese characteristic was necessary for new art. The title of the work, As an Art, also suggests Li's ambitious exploration in the existential truth for art. Instead of the literati convention that dominated Chinese art for centuries, the Dongfang artists looked to pre-modern culture for inspirations. Dongfang in Chinese means Eastern, so from the East. A later work by Li, here on the top left, along with several others by fellow Dongfang artists, testified to the effort in integrating ancient symbols, oracle bone scripts, deconstructed characters, stroke combinations, surface qualities of bronze sculptures, calligraphic movements, and exploring their potential as the basis of abstraction and a marker of a globally legible modernity. Concurrent with the Dongfang Society was the Fifth Moon Society, founded in 1956, the same year as the Dongfang Society, by graduates of the art department of the National Normal University and named after Salon de Mai, an avant-garde group in 1920s France. The artists of this group sought to combine the spirit and aesthetics of Chinese ink painting with the language of abstract expressionism. They pushed the boundaries of what landscape painting could constitute and provoke and provoked the cultural establishment in favor of classical landscape painting, best represented by the masterpieces in the Palace Museum collection that were brought to Taiwan by the nationalist government. Many artists in this group explored the materiality in their painting by using unorthodox techniques, instruments, or materials to diversify the surface texture. In doing so, they also expanded the vocabulary and visual styles for abstract painting. Perhaps because of their abstract landscape painting directly reference and in some ways reiterate the monumentality and idealism of classical landscape painting, the Fifth Moon artists received more support from the establishment as well as from foreign scholars of Chinese art, identifying them as the torchbearers of modern Chinese painting. The art of Dongfang and Fifth Moon can be understood as recuperative efforts in establishing deeper connections with one's cultural roots and identity after major national crises while pursuing modernity in universal terms. The spirit of experimentation and the resulting new visuality electrify the social atmosphere. At the same time was the emergence of modernist poets who joined the collective effort of defining the voice of a generation. The poets, also mainland-born, and experienced a horror of war and forced separation, sought to break away from traditional formats of classical Chinese poetry. They imported ideas from symbolism and surrealism, absorbed existentialist philosophy, and conveyed their own experiences of displacement, nostalgia, rupture, and complex emotions in their poems. As they fought the traditionalists on language and prose, they found in their painter peers kindred spirit and visualizations of their words. Oops. At the inaugural exhibition of Dongfang Society, the Bandits' exhibition, modern poets including Chu Ge, Xing Yu, Xiang Ming, and the leader of radical modernist poetry, Ji Xian, were among the most enthusiastic supporters. Other poets like Luo Fu, Ya Xian, Luo Men, and Yu Guangzhong were closer to painters in the Fifth Moon Society. The rapport between the artists and poets were remarkable. Artists made illustrations or designed book covers for the poets, and the poets wrote criticism of the art for newspapers and magazines. And here are two examples of the crossovers of the two communities. Worth noting is the military background of many poets and painters during this time. Four founding members, which is half of the Dongfang Society, were in the Air Force. Two of the Fifth Moon artists were in the Navy. In post-war Taiwan, the military was a powerful cultural producer. They funded arts and literature periodicals and magazines and encouraged artists, writers, and poets in service to publish and circulate their work. While the original purpose was to promote patriotism and traditional culture, progressive and experimental viewpoints also proliferated through that platform, and like-minded artists encounter each other's works through it. Another network within the diasporic population is a school for the orphans of nationalist military officers, which brought Li to Taiwan. Among its attendees were Li's fellow Dongfang artist Huo Gang and the Fifth Moon artist Liu Guosong. They, as well as those in the military, were bound by the experience of war trauma, displacement, nostalgia, and shared experience under the auspice of nationalist government that was both nurturing and restrictive. The stories of the mass migration in 1949 and its aftermath have been well documented, but most significant for the purpose of our discussion is how the period of pain and suffering and extreme ennui in a martial law society had created a robust creative community and artistic expressions. Within this network of young, restless, and passionate artists, cross-disciplinary exchanges and synergy ushered in a golden period of arts and literature development in Taiwan. Modern media in the post-war Taiwanese society was also a pivotal platform for publicity and exchanges between artists and their friends from other disciplines. As He Fan's explosive article in the United Daily News can attest, modern media played an important role in the dissemination of the ideas in modern art. In many other communities, from America to Japan to Brazil, the modern media also played big roles in the popularization of modern art and ideas. Two important monthly literary and arts publications, Wenyi Zaji, Wenxing, and Bihui, here I show the inaugural issues of both magazines, were key platforms of publishing and disseminating of modern art and poetry. Wenxing, established in 1957 on the left, was edited by He Fan, the author of the Bandit article, and he hired an open-minded writers to manage the art content. The magazine had become a major source of information on Western literature and Chinese and Western art and art history. In one instance, it shows a juxtaposition of Kandinsky, Pollock, with masterpieces of Chinese cursive calligraphy by Sun Guoting and the monk Huai Su. The visual affinity of abstraction is thus established, while it gave theoretical justification to the calligraphic abstraction of Li and his peers. While it is difficult to prove that Li had browsed through these pages, it is within reason to assume that the information of abstract art from foreign sources circulated amongst the culture class and were debated along traditional calligraphy. The magazine also defined the zeitgeist of the time. The short-lived literary magazine Bi Hui, edited by yet another orphan school alumnus, Yu Tiancong, was the first literary magazine to display both Fifth Moon and Dongfang work side by side in 1960, as the two groups garnered much reputation. The works show a shared interest in surface texture, gestural movements, abstract forms, and messy, anxious, raw emotions unfamiliar in the classical Chinese painting lexicon, and thus push forward aesthetics of a new generation. Bound by a collective nostalgia of the homeland, yet manifested in different ways, this generation of artists harnessed a perpetual sadness and mystery in their work, which might explain why they chose abstraction of landscape painting, which symbolizes both an interiority, and literally the land, and archaic symbols as departure points in the first place. So you can see Li's work right here. Most of the Dongfang artists left Taiwan in early 1960s for Europe. Oh, wait, sorry. I conclude this Taipei section by looking at a few works, Li, that would summarize his artistic explorations in a Taipei period. And here you see on the left more of a Mondrian-esque, Kandinsky-esque sort of exploration in the early 1950s, and to the right, the more calligraphic expression that he had made for, I think there are about 300 works that exist. But I must talk about this work from 1960, which is in the M Plus collection. It's a long form, kind of in the scroll form, about 7 meters long. I think a few of you have seen this in my exhibition last year. What's interesting, while it's so long, I made these in two sections. There's a signature here on the left end, but also a signature on the right end. So it suggests that you can read it from left to right and to right, from the right to left. Traditional Chinese hand scrolls are read only from the right to left. So he's really making this a circular activity, as well as intimate. It's impossible to show this work on a slide. So it really creates a kind of request for an intimate sort of viewing experience. Of course, you can see the composition of this painting reminiscent of a landscape painting, but as well as kind of musical score that kind of breathes through the space. And if you really study this closely, there are about 100 kinds of dots on this really interesting little painting. This was also the first work I bought for the museum. Most of the Dongfang artists left Taiwan in the early 1960s for Europe, primarily because one of the founding artists of the group, Xiaoqing, moved to Spain in 1955, and then Italy the year after. In 1962, Li Yuanjia embarked on a new beginning in Bologna under the invitation of Dino Gavina, the furniture designer and patron whose social circle included prominent artists, architects, and designers at the forefront of modernist innovations. Marcel Duchamp, Lucio Fontana, Carlos Scarpa, Marcel Breuer, and Pier Giacomo Castiglioni all were frequent guests of the Gavina House and Workshop. Li established a studio and home on a Gavina premise and began a few fruitful years of artistic production, where he made acquaintances with senior artists and designers, an experience that allowed him to glean the most cutting-edge ideas from design and architecture for his art. In Bologna, he further distilled his ideas of the point and reduced the gestural calligraphic abstraction to even more minimalist markings. Li, for a while, prepped canvas for Fontana. Though their abstract impulses have very different sources, from their work you can see the meeting of sensibilities. As Guy Brett has well argued in his essay, The work by Li and by Fontana share a, quote, cosmological element in their work, unquote, and that Fontana's piercing of the surface, like Li's cosmic points, embody contradictions in a singular gesture. Actually, in the background here is Fontana's work in the Govina House. Being in a foreign environment prompted Li to look for inspiration from his mother culture, a trope not unfamiliar to immigrant artists. One of the major innovations Li made in Bologna was the new format and constructive frames of his paintings. Concertinas, as we had talked about before, are reinterpretations of Chinese folding albums. Framed paintings, here on the left, two paintings, and reliefs in elongated rectangles take the proportions of hanging scrolls. And most significantly, the large relief diptychs or triptychs inherited the form of the traditional Chinese altar arrangements or interior wall furnishings that include a pair of couplets and centerpiece. What I'm describing is here, a traditional household, you will see a centerpiece with couplets kind of hung that way. In this outdoor image from the Govina archives on the left, one sees Li at work with a painted wooden relief triptych. Perhaps it is the environment of Govina's furniture business and the discussions around modern design for the home that prompted Li to take on the form of the triptych. The argument is also supported by the fact that Li was never so interested in high culture, but more drawn to vernacular customs and beliefs, so taking cues from interior decorations of common Chinese households is possible. Through Dongfang Society Xiaoqing, Li was involved in the activities of the Ponto Group in Milan and Bologna. Established in 1961, the members included Antonio Calderara, Kanjiro Azuma, Lucio Fontana, and Xiaoqing and Li Yuanjia. Xiaoqing labeled their central philosophy mindful contemplation, Jing Guan, a Taoist-inspired understanding of the process of making art. They value subjectivity and control, not the spontaneous expressions. The point in the Punto's belief is, quote, solemn, pure, positive, eternal, and constructive, unquote. From these works, one can see the sources and affinity of Li's aesthetics and process. And you see here on the left a work by Xiaoqing, a point appears. The Chinese writing translates to chaos, which is the primordial beginning of the universe in both Taoist beliefs and Western science. My paper, oh, that's also in the M Plus collection. My paper sought to outline Li Yuanjia's collaborative and cross-disciplinary way of working in the beginnings, the chapters of his artistic career. I explored the artistic networks and communities of artists in Taiwan, as well as the artistic networks in Bologna and Milan that have been crucial to the formation of Li's career. His career from 1952 to 66 provided an important way of conceptualizing cross-disciplinary, cross-medium alliances in post-war modernist art. His personal trajectory also enabled us to think more deeply about a global network of post-war art movements in non-centers such as Taipei, Bologna, Milan, then to London and Cumbria, even to Sao Paulo, that have yet to be fully explored in current art historical studies. I look forward to the next beginnings of research that Li's work will continue to inspire. And before I conclude, I would like to thank lots of people, a community of people that help with these research. That includes the LYC Foundation, everyone in it, Yowei and Kaiwei, who are two researchers who spent 7 years cataloging the LYC Foundation holdings, colleagues at Taipei Fine Arts Museum, artists, poets, and editors in Taiwan that I talked to, Sylvia Govina, daughter of Dino, and researcher Jiang Boxing in Taiwan, and Lucy Steeds. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon.
Wow.
There have been so many interesting talks and such an interesting dialogue that I want to try and pick up on one or two ideas that we've been talked about. So if I sort of ad-lib a bit, please forgive me. First of all, thank you very much to all the organisers for wonderful work that's been done, and also for inviting me. It's a real privilege to come and talk about Winifred and Li. And I found it, excuse me, very interesting process to think about this more deeply. Sorry. I'm also very conscious that those who knew the LYC, so I always talk about, I know it's the LYC Museum and Art Gallery, but it's always referred to as the LYC. Very conscious that those who knew the LYC have very strong opinions about the museum, and I hope that what I'm going to say will chime with their memories. Others knew Lee, also we always refer to him as Lee. Others knew Lee and the LYC extensively, in particular Nikki Sawyer, Donald Wilkinson, Mark Jones, former director of the V&A, Richard DeMarco, Andy Christian, and Joy D. And I'm indebted to them all for discussing the LYC with me on a number of occasions. And it's absolutely a delight to see Nikki and Joy here today. When Lee arrived in Cumberland, as it was in 1968, I have to point this out, I'm sorry, as a native Cumbrian, as it was then, 1968, Winifred was in her early 70s. And you might have been surprised that an artist who'd come to prominence 40 years previously should be interested in a young Chinese conceptualist. However, Winifred came from an open-minded background. Her brother, Wilfred Roberts, when he was a Liberal MP in the 1930s, he later post-war became Labour, had been instrumental in bringing Basque children refugees from the Spanish Civil War to the UK, some of whom Winifred taught painting. And when Winifred lived at Boothby, which was during the war, which was then her parents' house, there were Jewish refugees in the house, as well as a white Russian. Significantly, when Winifred visited America in 1964, she enthused about the op art she had seen there. And she owned a kinetic multiple by Takis, all poles and flashing lights. And her daughter, Kate Nicholson, who's also a painter, was very familiar with what was going on in the Signals Gallery in London. But most importantly, Winifred had what Ben Nicholson, her former husband, described as a gift for friendship with artists. And at various times she'd befriended Christopher Wood, William State Murray, Alfred Wallace, Mondrian, Arp, Hellion, and Gabo. And I think it's significant that she commissioned Gabo at a particular moment when he was low in his affairs. Given this, it was natural that she should befriend Lee. Now, this photograph, I should say, as Herman put it, it's by Richard DeMarco from 1975, but it's the library at the LYC, and I will talk a moment about the library. Boothby. Lee's studio was up here. And you approach it by a staircase, which came up this way. It's obviously it's no longer there. Which Winifred took her grandchildren to go and see him there. We used to go and play ping pong. I should point out that Winifred's Winifred lived in these rooms when she came to Boothby after the war. Because of their size, they were known as the cat killers. If you were really looking closely at some of the photographs we've seen, you will have seen Lee's ping pong table. This came to Winifred's house after he moved to Bankside. I'm sorry, it's quite large, so it's not that easy to photograph. The fun in this is that depending on where the ball lands, it bounces differently. So the Little Missenden Festival, this was run by Pat Harrison, who was the mother of Winifred's daughter-in-law. So I think Winifred would have had a key role in organising this exhibition which Lee had at Little Missenden Festival, which is in Buckinghamshire, in 1970. So already we're seeing Winifred is organising exhibitions for him. I hope you can see this. I was really pleased to see this in the film upstairs. Winifred couldn't sell Bankside. There was a crack. Now, I'd always thought it was a crack, you know? Can you see that? That's what you call a crack. And I think one of the things I do want to point out is, although Winifred sold back Tsai to Lee at an extremely favourable rate, and I think he paid it to her over a period of time. I remember him coming at one point and paying the last instalment, and Winifred being slightly surprised that he paid on time. But she did stipulate one thing, and that is that he should run it as a museum for 10 years. So I think although by 1982 he was probably, as people have said, quite exhausted, he had also fulfilled his commitment. Now, this is the exterior from 1982, but you can just see here, it's got this structure to support the outside. So Lee has taken on this building with this enormous crack, and I love this idea, which Lee has taken on this project, which everyone else had balked at, and I think that's a wonderful sort of symbolism of the way in which the museum starts. So one of the things he does is he has this open access library. I only know of one museum which has an open access library, and that's Kettle's Yard. It's rather interesting that that should be there because of the link with Kettle's Yard and Winifred Nicholson. This is, I'm pretty sure this is one of Winifred's books, and I think she gave him a whole series of them from the sorts of works which she and her husband were collecting in Paris in the 1920s. Now, the interesting thing here is the BN at the top. These are lovely, really early editions with beautiful black and white photographs. And again, here we've got Renoir, and look at that, Nicholson. Imagine going into the LYC in the 70s and seeing these extremely interesting books. And I think so generous of Winifred to share them with a wider audience. Winifred had 5 cosmic point multiples. We love playing with these as children. And she showed them in her main room. This is her main sitting room. Obviously there's this. But look at this. It's right next to Ben Nicholson's 6 circles. I love this piece. It's been a real joy to have a look at it again. It's about 9 inches wide. When you first put it up, after a while it sits and it's static. But when you first put it up, it moves. And depending where the light's coming from, because it's so white, it reflects the light. I think it's extraordinarily beautiful. And also, it's very interesting, last talk, we were talking about Fontana. I like this hole and the shape. Oh, sorry. And it's got this rather beautiful signature on the inside of the hole. And you have to think, this has come from Winifred Nicholson's collection, and you have to think she must have loved these white pieces because think of the white reliefs which her husband was making in the 1930s. But it has a companion piece which is black. And there are a number of these white and black works which links up to, I think, one of the discussions we were having before about Dark Side of the Moon. So I took this photograph of family gathering about Christmas time because I was interested in the people. It turns out it's actually now much more interesting for what's behind. Winifred had 3 of these Hessian wall hangings. And we've been talking about interaction. These were curtains. So you'd open them during the day and there were 2 large windows behind them. I loved these when I was growing up, and they are for me still some of my most favourite of his works, and I'm sorry that there hasn't been more emphasis put on them. I think it's interesting, one of the questions we had before was about calligraphy, and they relate very much to all sorts of Chinese things. I think there's an interesting relationship with Dom Sylvester Hutterdahl. I love them. There you can see. This one is now in Tully House, in Carlisle. Oh, wait, when you're photographing. If you need better images, please contact me later on. This is a snapshot I took in someone's house recently, purchased by one of Winifred's friends. So she's encouraging her friends, who are major collectors of Winifred's paintings. She's encouraging her friends to buy his works. And they don't have just one, they've got two. Aren't they gorgeous? I think they're so humorous too. Great fun, and such imagination. And large. Now, Winifred encouraged many of her friends to come and share at the LYC. Valerie Thornton, who was a printmaker, lived in the south. This is the Bucastle Cross, which, if you know northeast Cumberland, is what Pevsner describes as the finest monument in Europe from the 9th century. She also shared with her husband, Michael Chase. And this is Mary Newcomb, who shared a show with Winifred at the LYC in 1979. Mary Newcomb lived in the south. Winifred knew her through the Crane Cowman Gallery because they both showed her. Both showed there. So she's bringing these other artists in. And this is Thetis Blacker, who was a friend of, more really a friend of, I think, Kathleen Rain. She's a batik artist. And I was thrilled to see this in the black and white film. It's actually, it's tantalizingly short. There's a very, very short piece which shows Thetis Blacker's exhibition. And I think the person on the right is Thetis Blacker. Also, Kate Nicholson, Winifred's daughter, had two shows at the LYC. My brother, Winifred's grandson, had a show, as did my mother. This was my brother just before he went to Newcastle Art College. This is a rug, again, this appeared in one of the very early other photographs, which, and I was very pleased to see that Isain Holt was talking about the Corky rugs. It's a North Country tradition. Winifred was very keen on this, and she really tried hard to re-establish these. She designed these, and they were made by other people with these strips of reused fabric. But this was bought by the UEA in 1975 from the LYC. At that time there were rug making workshops. But interestingly, Lee actually also himself designed a rug, and I think that this one moment almost symbolises to me the whole way in which there's this connectivity going on. Lee made the frame for this picture by Winifred. It's beautifully made in pristine white. But I just want you to hold the image of that Winifred. This is the sort of picture that she was making in the 1970s. And we'll see, for me, there's so many interesting things going on here, but what I come to at the end is the way in which I think he totally changed what she was painting. And Flower Tales, which she produced, an edition of 500. Winifred wrote a lot of stories, beginning, I think, post-war, and there's still a number which hopefully at some point will be published, but this is the only these are the only ones which have been published, and it was due to Lee that they're out there. So I think that was again, this was something that he was doing, which was very important for her. So I've moved on from my notes a little bit. This is Carthage. Really, she had a trip to North Africa in 1970. She wrote to Ben. Ben and Winifred had a very, very interesting correspondence right throughout their life after they separated. I adore criticism. I'm very grateful for it. I get all too little up here. The only person who gives me any is a young Chinaman, Lee. He's exhibited in Rome, Florence, and in Signals. He makes things that the spectator participates with, that is, large white magnetic panels on which one places wooden circles to one's liking. When Lee places them, they have meaning. When other people move them, they have none. He said to me yesterday, the way you paint fast what you feel and want to paint is fine for making a picture as you can. But to take the next step and make a masterpiece. You must know what you do not like and what you cannot do, and think, not only feel, how can one do that, by painting very slowly. When you're painting what you feel, you can and must paint very fast, as you do. When you're after that with your thoughts, you must paint very, very, very slowly. I'm not sure she took that last bit of advice. Interesting. The owner of this picture told me that Lee said to Winifred, every painting must have a bit of red in it. And look. Isn't it great? And what's it? I don't know what it's doing there, but she loved experimenting, and she will take on all sorts of ideas from me. As we've heard, Winifred had 4 shows at the LYC. The most I found of anyone else is 2. The last one was posthumous. And I have to say, the 1976 show, she showed her abstract paintings, which she'd mostly made in Paris in the 1930s. So it was a very, she's showing her some of her most avant-garde works here at this time, and really experimenting, so gauging people's opinions of what she's up to. Winifred met, through the LYC, the artist Donald Wilkinson. And this is where it begins to get really interesting. Donald knew that Winifred had been to the Isle of Egg in the Hebrides in the 1950s with Kathleen Ray. And he said to her, let's go. So in 1980, they went up. Donald Wilkinson and his family for the first week, Valerie Thornton and Michael Chase for the second, and for both weeks, Kate. This is one of Winifred's best-loved pictures. And without Lee, I don't think we would have it. Similarly, Winifred owes a huge debt to him, but there's more to come. Sorry. This is the opening of her exhibition in 1979. She's talking to Godfrey Bennett, who was also, he was a friend of Lowry, an amateur artist. He's also someone who showed at the LYC. At the end of his life, he lived in Carlisle. Behind, we've got Kate, and this is Donald Wilkinson. So here at the opening, we've got 4 people who showed at the LYC. I don't know who the others are, so if Nikki or Joy do know, I'd be most interested. Also, we've got one of his very recognisable pieces of sculpture, furniture. What's interesting about this show is that Winifred, beginning to show some of her most experimental art. Oh, sorry, I was going to go on and say about Egg. Kate made 4 trips to the Isle of Egg. The last one was myself. So it had direct influence on me, and there's what I like to think of this sort of cascade of influences going on. What had been going on? You have to think, Winifred is, 2 minutes' drive, living 2 minutes' drive from the LYC. And I'm sure she went to just about every opening. There were shows by Paul Inigo, David Nash, Andy Goldsworthy twice, James Huguenin, Sheila Wakely, to mention just a few. There was paintings, sculptures, pottery, photographs, installation, felt makers, tapestries, weaving, and as we've had from Madeleine Hookers yesterday, video. And I was really interested in talking to Madeleine afterwards, that she went and met Winifred on a number of occasions. And I think, and the word she used was open. And I think that's so interesting. Joy D, who assisted at the LYC, recalls Winifred sitting in the front row during a performance by a young artist. Winifred was wearing her plastic, knee-length red boots. Performance by young artists. Jerry C. Cooper shelves materials. I haven't managed to find anything more about him, but I, I think this is wonderful, and I would love to see it repeated. I think it's very, very apposite today. He came in with a tool bag, took out his tools, screwed a shelf to the wall, and placed the tools on it. I'd love to know what Winifred was thinking as she watched Gary C. Cooper, but I bet she appreciated the humour and the irony. There are all these things going on. What effect did they have on Winifred? Now, to quote from Kate, I look at modern things, but stick to my own idea. But somehow, having looked at the modern things, something that they have gets absorbed into one's own work. My thesis is that the LYC and Lee gave Winifred the encouragement to express herself freely in her late pictures. This is plant for a present. She'd always been interested in prisms and the way in which they use light. She says, I found out what flowers know, how to divide the colours as prisms do into longer and shorter wavelengths, and in so doing giving the luminosity and brilliance of pure colour in the ordered sequence of the octave of colour. So she's really experimenting, and you can see the way in which these bright rainbow colours are being infused into her work. I particularly wanted to show this work because you can see it here on the wall. Yeah, that's plant for a present. And also here's the plants, the white streptocarpus, which incidentally is sitting in, I should have shown it, it's sitting in a white, very classical Chinese vase, which her friend E.J. Hooper, who'd been in China in the 1930s, and was also a stalwart supporter of the LYC, it's sitting in this Chinese vase. So then we have plant for a present. Winifred is extraordinarily experimental in these last pictures. I'm just going to show you two. Hover. This is so different from what she was doing before. And I think this willingness to experiment and try new things comes straight out of the enthusiasm and the energy and the excitement that she's experiencing in the LYC. And Clarion Call and Whisper, this is one of my absolute favourites. Again, you can see the way in which she's using the prism, she's split up the prismatic colours. So on the bottom right-hand corner, there are these two, I think they're Greek shells, they're about this bit, you tend to find the yellow and the red colours get dispersed and the cooler colours up on this sort of wafting shape. These prismatic pictures were extremely important for Winifred. They were only she showed a few at the LYC just to see in 1979, and then the main show was in the Crane Kalman Gallery in 1981, sadly 3 weeks after she died. The problem with them is there are none in public collections. So it's very difficult to see them and access them. LYC. There were doll making workshops, puppet making workshops, tapestry weaving, glass engraving, Saturday evening art and music workshops. I think they were more social than anything else, I seem to remember. Felt making workshops, and I must point out that there's a photograph which is regularly shown, it's described as rug making. It's not, it's felt making with Jenny Cowans, so please. Poetry readings, including Kathleen Rain, close friend of Winifred's, and also Francis Horowitz and others, and the wonderful children's room. Amongst others, there was work by Chinese, German, Norwegian, American artists. One of the things we were talking about previously was the... Oh, I'll come on to this moment. But I think, thinking about it, Lee's really unique achievement was to create an open space which allowed anyone to express their innate creativity. I think this is Winifred and Lee in their house, again by Richard DeMarco in 1975. If you think Lee's sitting slightly precariously, it's because he's on a William Morris chair. Winifred's, she's changed the proportions of the legs. If you sit back too far, you flop over. But, I think this unique achievement is to create an... open space which allowed anyone to express their innate creativity. I think for Winifred, if you weren't creating, you weren't alive. And I think that's something that comes through with Lee, and I think they were chimed with each other on that. And also, I think she would have loved this idea of having a gallery run without a committee. We heard earlier on about Lee sending out his catalogues to his friends and also his calendars. I counted up, there were about over 1980, there were 203 friends. They're actually listed in the calendar, so you can see who were friends. But I love this idea, as also we were talking about. It's very democratic, and this way extending everything. But I wanted to end by quoting from the calendar from 1980. It actually has got Joy Lee's name at the bottom of it, but I think this comes straight from Lee. What Lee has made is more than a building. It embodies all his space, time, life ideas, and his desire to share them. People who regret the apparent end of Lee's artistic output should see that the drive behind the building is the same as the one behind the watercolours and wood structures. It is a work of art. And when it's finished, something else will take its place. Thank you.
Well, I think friendship has come up sort of numerous times, actually, through the day. And I'm particularly thinking of that very emotive newspaper clipping, looking for friends, Lee's looking for friends, which is very heart-rending. And just this idea that you were just saying there, that there was 203, did you say, friends of the gallery? And this different sort of sense that we use friends to mean these kind of people who help or assist in an institutional basis, and how those friends can be kind and beneficent, but also they can limit you. And this kind of idea of not wanting to run by committee, but wanting to have a sense of freedom as well from one's friendship or from groups. And so I just kind of want to run with this idea that maybe friendship and group work can be both really satisfying and wonderful, and we want to kind of evoke this idea of conviviality, but also that it can be difficult and dangerous and full of conflict. And this has also come up before, I think, today as well, this idea that, you know, that poem that we saw where there was unrequited love and no woman and no friends for Christmas, and it, you know, this idea of at once having all of these great friends and all of this support for Lee, but also a lack of belonging. And so I was thinking about the different kind of ideas of groups and friendship that both of your papers kind of gave us or discussed, and this sense of like the formative moments of Lee's practice in your paper, Leslie, and then in your paper this idea of a kind of give and take between Lee and Winifred, and how I was so fascinated that there was kind of idea of agreement and disagreement, and him kind of feeding back to her, as well as I suppose she talked to him about his work as well, and this sort of idea of them kind of having a dialogue across generation, across very different kinds of practice, is totally fascinating and rare. And this is also what's going on in speech acts, right, where you've purposefully tried to disrupt all of these kind of curatorial narratives that you might want to kind of fixate upon. And then also, just because I'm thinking about Kettle's Yard, and you mentioned Kettle's Yard a few times too, and the sense that there are other institutions which are built around this idea of being a friend to artists. A friend to artists is what Jim Eade always calls himself, who's the founder of Kettle's Yard. And this idea of living with artworks. You showed us a lot of artworks in Winifred's house and in the house in the Bologna house. Yeah. And just how these kind of private collections or artworks that circulate between friends offer us very different ideas of conversational dialogue with artworks, different kind of ideas of art history, potentially. And also, practically, she bought artworks to support people, and Jimmy did the same as well. So those are some kind of trails that I sort of wanted to pick out between the kind of papers that you presented. But I just wanted to hear more, Lesley, as well, what you thought the kind of impact of those groups was on Lee. Do you think there was a kind of dialogue and exchange that really sort of shaped his work? And then similarly, Jovan, do you think Winifred had an influence on Lee and his work?
Thank you for your question. I think the early period of the Dongfang group, as I showed, they were all exploring these pre-modern motifs from scripts, oracle bones, and such. It's a collective exploration. Everybody looked at the same sources, but then each took away something different. But in the end, they all were trying to look for this, I guess, mystical beginning of this ancient culture, which not necessarily has to be Chinese, but it's sort of universal and ancient and Chinese at the same time. So I think you see those motifs coming back in his tapestries, rugs, and later, right? These kind of almost universal symbols, simplified hieroglyphs, if you will. So I think that collective pursuit early on in his career was informative. I guess it also planted the seeds for later works. But when you said earlier that group work could be satisfying and dangerous, I think when you're in a small group of artists bound by certain circumstances, there are competitions, there are people who are more vocal than others, some are more fortunate, you know, things like that. So Lee is actually quite a silent member of this group, even though I think his work is very explosive. So each of them left Taiwan at different times and care for each other's work, but I feel when I talk to them, there is a little bit of competition. I think anybody who worked with groups understand this kind of curiosity of what others are doing, but at the same time, competitive in a perhaps constructive and friendly way. So that's inevitable in looking at painting societies or, you know, groups. And we should also think about the groups banded together in exhibitions by circumstance, but also by necessity, because there weren't many places for exhibitions during that time in Taiwan. It's totally self-organized. So those are, you know, when you have like-minded people in your private lesson group, of course, if you get invited or there's a chance, you would exhibit together. So you'll see their work sort of develop in totally different routes later on, but in that early beginning, they have the same sort of point of departure.
Well, I think it's a really quite dynamic friendship, and over what 68 to 81, that's a good period of time. And you know, things change, and they go up and down, and so on. Lee wasn't always the easiest of people. If you talk to Andy Christian, he says that Winifred had a wonderful understanding of what he was saying. How much he actually influenced what he was doing, I don't know. I suspect the job.
Yeah, can I just say, from what he said to me, that her friendship was terribly important to him, and I'm quite sure that one of the things that contributed to his loneliness and towards the end of the, you know, LYC and the closure, I think he closed it, it may have been later if she had lived longer. I think she was a completely, you know, important part of LYC and of Lee's feeling. It was a wonderful friendship. It was a, you know, a mutually beneficial.
That's very interesting. I mean, just to sort of, I mean, to recap, she died early in 1981. She closed at the age of, at the end of 1982.
Yes. Yes, I mean, so what he said to me, it was almost a contributing factor to closing.
So perhaps we could open that. Does anyone have any questions?
Hi, just a question for Lesley about the publication of the Fifth Moon Society, where painters and writers contributed for it. And I was just wondering, at the presentation about these publications and that relationship, and I was wondering if this was a sort of common practice that probably would have known at the time, everyone. Mm. Of having publication made in collaboration with writing, poetry, right. And as right. Well as, yeah.
So the two publications that I talked about, the two that I showed the covers, both were actually, one of them is self-funded, the more short-lived one. The other one is funded almost, well, it's also a sort of private funding, but the person had some backings in the journalistic sort of community. So these two, I should have clarified, they're not military-backed, but there are other military-backed publications. So there are all these different circulations of publications that were going on in Taiwan at the time that allowed for these kind of creative experiments. So I think my thesis or hypothesis is that because of this, publication culture is quite prevalent during that time. Youngsters who are creating or going to exhibitions or making poetry will be very aware of who's being published, you know, this month, and who's making what publication. Perhaps that has something to Lee's later on work, where this is a place where you could create a virtual community by mail or by inviting people, and how you could create sparks amongst the different disciplinary practitioners.
Thank you.
Well, I'd just like to ask a follow-up question about the circulation of those journals, because I see very similar juxtapositions between abstract expressionism and both calligraphy, ink painting, but also this new kind of cultural painting practice happening in a couple of Japanese journals. Yeah. So Bokubi, Butai, are also doing these kinds of juxtapositions. And I'm wondering, to what extent did these journals circulate within Asia?
Very good question, and I know your work on the Japanese journals. And I've asked the artists, a lot of them that I work on are still alive in their 80s. They're not really aware of the Japanese publications at all. The magazines that I featured in this presentation circulated amongst the Chinese communities in Asia. I know this because they're prices in the masthead listed Hong Kong, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore, Malaysia, and the US. So these overseas offices that they had are in fact friends they have in those locations. So I think it's very similar in a lot of the publication practices in these groups. But yeah, there was almost no knowledge of, my dissertation had a whole chapter on this, but they know something of Japanese and arts and culture, but not the Gutai group, not the calligraphers.
But they might have known about informal coming from Japan, right?
Informal came in from Li Zhongsheng, also their teacher, and from the publications that are at the American libraries, USIS libraries that are in these Pacific regions, but yeah, sort of indirectly. And I guess Xiaoqing also was already in Spain and Italy in 1950, so he was actually very actively writing reports from Europe to send to United Daily News, the first newspaper that I mentioned. So there's these, it's a very individual kind of news broadcasting for artistic movements from abroad through these very singular channels that it came through.
I have another question for Lesley. I was just really curious. It sounded like Lee had a really great thing going on in Taipei, and I'm wondering why he moved to Bologna, and also considering his humble origins, I wondered how.
So the legends had it that Xiaoqing, his friend, was already showing in Italy, living in Italy, and exhibited a work of Li's And apparently Dino Gavina went to see the show and said something like, oh, I would love to meet this artist. And somehow a letter got to Lee. So the legends had it that Lee showed up in Bologna and said, you know, I'm this person that you wanted to meet. And then Gavina was open and welcoming and hence started his residency in Bologna. So
I think what happens is also that Dino Gavina actually sponsored him to be able to go.
So it's again, it's a singular channel of our serendipitous.
Okay, so what do you mean by sponsor, like financially or
no, in terms of visa?
Visa.
Okay.
Yeah.
So. But I mean, I think the impetus for me to go was literally. I mean, they had this kind of creative art scene amongst a small group, but this was still, you know, a very politically repressive place, and for someone who, you know, always wanted this space and freedom. And see, you know, I keep on referring back to space and freedom because these were really two sort of really important concepts in his life. And, you know, having been to these military orphanages over and over again to end up in, you know, Taipei Teachers College, which was also military run, he was still living that institutional life. So this, the kind of art circles was a different thing, but it was very, very depressive. There was a lot of poverty. You know, it wasn't a pleasant kind of life. I think he wanted to get away from that. And that's my understanding.
I think there's also the the artistic atmosphere was vibrant in the sense of, you know, there's a lot of creativity coming out of this impoverished situation. But as I also kind of alluded to, the Fifth Moon Group was much more endorsed by the establishment as a rivalry between groups. I mean, they all know each other, but the Fifth Moon Group artists, some of them got Rockefeller grants to go to the U.S. and, you know, and because of the education system, National Normal College teaches, after you graduate, you teach high schools or universities. Whereas the college that Lee went to and his friends went to, you become an elementary school teacher. So differences in salary and social status. And there have been researchers in Taiwan had argued that because of the more humble beginnings and less sort of strong backing of Dongfang Group that led them to leave Taiwan when they can. I'm a little bit doubtful of that argument because they also had strong support from people of influence. So I think a lot of them is driven by personal reasons. If there's, in fact, during that time, if you have the means, you would go abroad. So, you know, and there's only one way, the one way ticket, it's not coming back. So, I think the outside world, in the Chinese saying, the moon outside is rounder.
I had a question. What kind of for both of you, but particularly just inspired by the photograph that is behind us. And we've seen some really incredible photographs of both Lee and Winifred's lives today. And it made me wonder, is it that serendipity and that people were around them taking these photographs? And we do have this kind of documentation of their worlds. Or was that part of, were they interested in that as well as having documents of their life and their friendships and kind of, you know, sort of prompted that recording? Because, you know, often you wish when you're working artists that you have photos of exhibitions and openings and they're never in the archive, but it seems like there's such a rich archive here.
Have you met Richard DeMarkin?
So it's mainly mainly him.
This one and the one that I showed at the beginning were Richard DeMarco, and a lot of ones that I showed. I think, you know, and there's a big archive there. I think we owe a huge debt to him. And Winifred wasn't interested in taking these sorts of photographs.
No.
It's quite, if I could talk about it a bit more, it's quite interesting in that she's sitting on the fabric which would have been made by the Edinburgh Weavers, which was run by a friend of hers, Alistair Morton. The cups are from Leech pottery sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
And the blue picture behind is by Kate, the sort of thing that she would have showed in her show in the at Leeds in, I think it was 74, 75.
I was thinking the yellow tablecloth is very, there's a good yellow vibe, isn't there?
Oh, she liked bright colours. Yeah. So it's very symptomatic. One of the things we were talking about before is her house. She moved pictures around all the time.
Yeah.
And she loved to bring out her most recent pictures and put them up. It was a constant sort of, I mean, in a sense, her house was her studio.
Yeah.
But you know, Richard Marker is extraordinary, and I remember him giving a talk at the LYC about his, I think he'd taken a group of students around the west coast on a sailing boat, the west coast of Scotland, on a sailing boat. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I hope that.
Yeah, it's interesting to think about documenting friendships.
But the one of the three. I took that out of that crumb. No, I wish I'd taken more.
Well, it's a good reminder to us all.
Yeah. Well, it's so much easier. I mean, I had a cheap little, and it's expensive then to get a process.
Yeah.
Well, under the gaze of the camera and with an eye on the time, I think we should maybe move on to the next session. That's okay, but please join me in thanking you.